Good evening, it's 6 o'clock. I'd like to call the meeting of the Reese and Queens Municipality Regular Council, May 24th, 2022, to order. I do have, going to add to the agenda the Mersey River Wind presentation, that's 3.2. Are there any other changes to the agenda? If not, I'll ask for approval of the agenda, moved by Counselor Charlton, seconded by Counselor Gidney. All those in favor? Presentations, Queens Community Health Board. Board?
We're up.
So Jackie, I know you, so perhaps you want to introduce your partner presenter?
She's gonna take it right from the.
Oh, she's gonna take it right from the get-go. Okay, I think you've been told that basically we allow 20 minutes, 10 minutes for presentation time, and then 10 minutes, which allows time, opportunity for council to ask questions.
Alrighty, on ready to go. Back to you.
So on behalf of Queens Community Health Board and our coordinator, who unfortunately wasn't able to join us today as scheduled because, well, COVID is still sneaking in the shadows. So on behalf of myself, I'm Barbara Ross, and this is Jackie, who a lot of you seem to already know. Thank you for allowing us to join you and share our presentation on child poverty. As you may already know, a key role of the health boards in Nova Scotia is to advocate for improved health and wellness in our community. So we listen and respond to the lived experiences of people throughout Queens County and create health plans underpinned by that really meaningful community engagement process, which I for certainly, for one, was part of the planning for the health plan that is currently, oh, with my little doofer not wanting to do.
Do we mention the fact that we have a meeting tomorrow?
Yeah, here we go. There we go. Alright, so the impact of child poverty is a critical issue which consistently leads our health board discussions year in and year out. And I have to say, I've been with the health board for 6 years, so I'm actually coming to my natural end on the health board, I mean, and hopefully no other way. Study after study describes the profound effect of poverty on our children's mental, physical development and its lasting impact into their adult life. At a local level, we see the evidence played out day in and day out. And as you can see from the slides, although childhood poverty has been reduced, I would call that pretty minutely, in the last 30 years, the uptake in food banks has increased by nearly 30%, which is pretty staggering. Nova Scotia has the highest rate of child poverty in the Atlantic provinces. It's the third highest in Canada. Child poverty rates for lone parents in Nova Scotia is 51.7%. Nova Scotia has the lowest welfare income in Canada for single parents. So they're really up against it. Child poverty in rate of census in our division, so the Queen's division, is 29.3, which is pretty frightening. More than one in four of our children living in Queens County lives in poverty. So let's just put that in context. In a class, school class of 30 children, 7 of those children are going to go to bed hungry, cold, and go to school without breakfast or lunch, missing out on recreational and social activities and living on the margins. I'm not fast enough with the doofer. By the way, doofer is a really common Scottish word for bits of equipment, just in case you heard. I was confusing everyone. each of them differently. Here we go. My apologies. So, in early, the early development instrument, which we're going to talk about, and I hope you've got copies of that document, it's a Canadian-made, internationally recognized research tool used to measure development or developmental health trends and changes in populations of five-year-olds. So these are kiddies who are going off to start school. The domains are good predictors of youth and adult health, education, and social outcomes. So as a nurse and midwife, I have certainly had lots of experience working in really poor communities, both in this country and in Scotland. And I've seen the impact of poor starts to children who have been brought up in single parent families with very little money. So children, just for your information, they attain their most critical development in the first 5 years of life. And yet paradoxically, the highest rate of poverty in children is under the age of six. So we're really not doing these kids any favors. 100% of families who rely on government support, these are social benefits, as their only source of income, live in deep poverty. The lack of basic nutritious, this is what I've seen as a midwife, the lack of basic nutrition during pregnancy and early infancy has a detrimental effect on childhood development. And what we're seeing is a lot of our preschoolers, our five-year-olds, are missing their basic preschool developmental milestones. Now, going back to the EDI instrument, we have a list of assessment categories that children within Nova Scotia have been measured at. Physical health and well-being, social competence, emotional maturity, language and cognitive development, communication skills, and general knowledge. These are little preschoolers. Children in Queens County have the lowest region on the scale of children on track to meet those five developmental assessment categories. So that's, again, something that is not a picture we want to see. Feels like forever, but we did hold a childhood poverty forum in October of 2019. Now, we partnered with Lunenberg Health Board, the Child and Youth Network, and 50 of our stakeholders to expose the reality of poverty in our local communities. The forum was organized around the EDI instrument data, which in itself was truly heartbreaking. Notes from our first voices came from people disproportionately affected by poverty living in Queens County. They shared personal stories of the children who have to shower at school and stuff their pockets full of toilet roll because there's no hot water at home and there's no toilet paper. These are children who have never visited a cinema, a swimming pool, a bowling alley, or a restaurant other than McDonald's. A byline announced, "Broken promises, let's not allow another generation to suffer." And then there was COVID. While the outcome of the pandemic is yet to be realized, the impacts of COVID will only deepen existing disparities in our families and our communities. Improved economic benefits can and will go a long way in mitigating the impact of the pandemic, but we know that the cost of living is rising exponentially. Heavens, leaving families and children vulnerable to hunger and food insecurity. and security. 25 years ago, as we'll see from the slide, all the parties in the House of Commons pledged to end child poverty by the year 2000. 22 years later, we're still waiting. The Queen's County Health Board recognizes that poverty is first and foremost about the lack of income to meet basic needs like food, rent, fuel, etc. But poverty is also about social and community exclusion. Economic inequality erodes social cohesion, empathy, compassion, and leads to increased social isolation, stigma, marginalization of the poor, distrust, sometimes crime, stress, and despair. And we know that children who are exposed to the hardships of poverty in every corner of the county, not dispelling the myth that more affluent neighborhoods are immune to the problem, because we know they're not. Unfortunately, there's no mention of child poverty in the federal or provincial budget that we're aware of. We truly believe that child health is very much a community issue, so we want to fill in those gaps. Poverty is about lack of money, but it's also a lack of hope. People living in poverty often feel powerless to change their situation, and they often feel quite isolated from their communities. Single mothers especially are vulnerable to both food insecurity and its negative physical and psychological health outcomes, including dietary inadequacy, so they're not eating well, chronic illness, social exclusion, depression, mental illness, and feelings of inferiority, embarrassment, and shame. Food bank users are often referred to as recipients rather than consumers of food, which reinforces that lack of control and powerlessness that can damage their sense of identity, pride, and self-worth. We know there are going to be challenges for engagement. We know there is hidden poverty in Queen's County. I've lived in many, many places in the world, and it's one of the few places that I've visited when poverty isn't absolutely obvious. I walked in the streets of, worked as a midwife in a public health nurse in Glasgow and Dundee, some of the worst places for poverty in Scotland, and I could point to you where the poverty was. I can't do that in Queen's, even though we know it's there. We know that the stigma of embarrassment for particularly children, we talk a lot to our colleagues in high schools and elementary schools of children who won't come forward because they're embarrassed. They don't want to feel different. They don't want to be judged. They don't even know where to go to get the help. If you can't afford to put data on your phone, you don't have a car, you can't afford petrol even if you had one, then that means that lack of access to services is going to be a huge problem. The other problem we have is sustainability. We often come up with solutions, but they only last as long as the funding lasts. So where do we go from here? Municipalities form the order of government closest to our families who are living that experience of poverty and Queens. They are Canada's eyes and ears on the ground, as we are with the health board. Going forward, we want to work together to identify and implement creative and innovative local solutions to help lift people out of poverty in Queen's County. Your position on the front lines of poverty, the region of Queen's municipality, can play a crucial role in guiding other orders of government, offering informed recommendations for transformational policy, action, and investment. And I've given some ideas of what we can be doing next. Is we need a clearer picture of poverty in our community. We need to educate people to understand that how serious the problem is. What are other municipalities doing? We know there's action in Lunenburg County that we can tap into, and we can collaborate with other organizations who are already offering some relief to people living in poverty. But what can we do today? So we've come up with some solutions, and this is just us. This is the health board members who are brainstorming some ideas that may sound a little far-fetched, but we think very passionately that these are things that we should be considering. We need to have a child poverty advocate and somebody who's got a lived experience. We were just chatting to say both of us have experienced hard times when we were growing up and as adults and parents, but not what these children are having to deal with. We need somebody who understands what those issues are. We need to access funding, and that includes our own wellness fund that's open to anybody who would like to tap into it. We need affordable transport, maybe a bus subsidy, free accessible childcare. Baby boxes, this is something that I know about from Scotland, but they can be adapted. So every baby that's born who is in need would get a baby box, and we can talk about that later. A book bag, this is something that's been tried before. We're trying to get these preschoolers past those 5 milestones so that they're not going to be disadvantaged for the rest of their time in school. What about fresh food boxes? This is beyond the food bank, by the way. Peer support programs. I don't know what it's like to live in abject poverty, but lots of people do. What about dental care credits? We know that for children who are not accessing, well, under their parents, who are not accessing dental care, can have a profound effect on their mental and physical health. Recreational passes, unlimited access to recreation, such an important part of their development. And finally, explore the distribution. And I was listening to the, I was going to say wireless, you'll be able to age me when I say that, the radio this morning about different programs who are looking at excess food from hotels, from shops, that rather than dumping them, as they have been doing, is how can we get a volunteer program up and running that would deliver this food directly to folk in need. So I thank you very much for your attention, and if you have any questions, we're both here to answer them.
Questions or comments for Barbara? Councilor Trill.
What do you particularly envision for the region of Queens? I'm seeing all of these, but is there certain ones or certain things that you think that we could potentially look at that would be helpful?
Any of them.
Any of these?
I mean, this was just our group, and I think at any given time there's maybe 10 people on our board. We're actually one of the most robust health boards in Nova Scotia and have been for many, many years. This is just our ideas off the cuff. There are so many more. That I'm sure people who have businesses here in Queens County would have some really, really helpful ideas of how we can use our expertise, our knowledge, our access to start addressing this really, really important group. Because these are the adults that we're going to see, well, maybe not me so much, but, this is going to be a social challenge. If we don't catch these kids as they go into elementary school, we've lost them.
And one of the things too, from when they did the Western Zone Health Plan in 2019, one of the things they did find that the success comes with a common vision. So that's all stakeholders come to the table. You don't have little pockets here and there. Who leads that? For example, even if you look at waste, food waste from restaurants, I mean, one of our youngest members of the board, a high school student, said, like, you know, let's take White Point, for example. You have a buffet, and that food is all thrown out. Why? You know, and I know there's health measures and things in place, but is there things that can be done as a community, as a municipality, that can make some changes in those laws so that we have people who can use that food rather than having it thrown out? We don't know. We're just coming to bring awareness of discussions we've had and wondering if you have any that are helpful as well. So, because part of the health plan in 2019, and then there's new health plan going to be coming forth in 2024, but we have to start planning now, I think, or is it 2023? And so in that health plan, we dealt with food insecurity, housing, recreation, wellness, and community connection. So we're starting to work more on the community connection in regards to all of this. And in the 2019 conference, or what did you have, a
forum,
it was one of the things that was stated very clearly was that everybody has to come to the table. So we know that, you know, this person, this group over here can connect with this group here, and we're going to make a bigger bang for our buck than if we have everybody working in isolation. So our first thought was that we would come here to talk with you to see if you know of anything, if there's anything we can do moving forward. I've been at these conferences for, I'm a retired teacher, 12 years ago, I'd been at the conference, and it was with Lunenburg, and they came up with recommendations. I looked at the recommendations from the forum in 2019, and I just didn't know what to say, because it's the same thing. Nothing has changed, and our kids are suffering, and single moms with kids are suffering the most. And if you want to look at these documents, they're all online. Our health plan is online, as well as the poverty report card for 2021. You'll find that online. And I believe we actually sent a link to that.
We all have that report in there.
Yeah. Very interesting read.
But sad.
But sad.
But we're still here, you know. And I think it's really, we can say, well, it's not our problem because the federal government is their problem, or it's the provincial government's problem. But it doesn't appear that action is happening. It's not a priority. Now, I appreciate that the housing piece seems to be moving forward, but that's not helping our kids right now in Queens County. And these are the ones that we're really, really worried about.
Yeah, can the municipalities have those discussions? Can you take it to the provincial government? I don't know. Like, but I guess the thing is that we figured starting here would be one of the first steps to take. And as when we even think about all of the organizations that are in this community, how often do we talk about child poverty? I don't know.
Barbara, to reach the children, you need to reach the parents.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
So the question is, how do you educate and reach the parents?
Exactly.
Various communities try community gardens, and they seem not to be successful. The daycare had a great community garden growing on their property, but then it takes work, and people, you know, they've done kitchens where they've tried to teach low-income homeowners how to produce better meals at a lower cost. But it needs capturing of the adults.
And I think I brought that out in the presentation, that there are, I think, legitimate reasons why adults shy away, because they do feel they're being identified, they're being judged, they're being, you know, they can feel the stigma. It's just like the same kids who don't ever want you to go to the breakfast club if they're the only ones, because that shows that they're the poor people, they're the ones who aren't working hard enough, they're not trying hard enough. And so I think that's why I made the point that we really have to look at peer support. If we want, you know, we need to have an advocate who can pull things together, who has that lived experience, who is able to make that connection without that person feeling as if they've been, you know, centered out. And I think a lot of it is, you know, embarrassment. People just don't want to feel different from each other, so they hide. And that's why they don't come to services, because it looks like, you know, they're the ones that are not doing it right, or they're not, you know, they're not managing their money right. You know, it's all that feeling of being judged all the time.
So from what I'm hearing, a first step for an organization, whatever it may be, would be to find that peer worker.
I think that would be a good start. But also I think that there has to be a willingness for the community, and this is part of the community, we're a part of the community, to come together and say, well, what can we offer?
And are you linked with North Queens as well?
Oh, with sure. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, Laura Lee is on our board.
Well, she's actually our chair. And I deliver hot meals for Vaughan in North Queens, and I do see, because I'm in some really rural communities. Yeah.
Councilor Brown?
Yeah, I sit on the Social Regional Library Board, and they've been advocating for some of these issues that you've got. One of them is so they do the baby book or the book bag.
Yeah.
To give everybody a book, like everybody at whatever age gets a book. And there's been a lot of talk about doing like a food library at some of the libraries, where excess food can be checked out with a library card. You know, like you go to the grocery store and you pick up your food, you have a locker combination. At a food library, somebody would be able to access that with a library card and take some of the stigma away if they can do things like that. And these are different things that are starting in some areas. The teaching kitchens and one of the other things that we talked about was food literacy, where people get things donated in food boxes, they don't know how to cook them.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes.
The library they're putting together information on saying, okay, if you've got this food, this is what it pairs with, this is how you cook it, this is what it's supposed to be, don't just throw it out.
Yeah, a bit like Chef's Plate, where
yeah.
you get the recipe
yeah.
with the food box.
But some of the libraries, the staff are putting together recipes and how to cook different items that may have been donated in a food box. If the food bank gets something and says, you know, we got 500 pounds of okra, who's going to use okra? You know, but they've got it, why waste it? So
yeah.
they try to teach people how to use it so that it doesn't go to waste as an item. So it's ways that we can start.
Yeah, and I think you put your finger on it. We just have to really be creative. But always in the back of our minds that we're not judging people, that we're, you know, we're finding ways to offer or to help lift people without highlighting them, you know.
And it's a sustainability of programs, so if a lot, it's wonderful.
Yeah.
And if everybody else was in on that as well, like it just will support each other and each other's programs so that they perhaps can be more sustainable versus a standalone. So one of the things is just bringing the community together and bringing the stakeholders together so that we're stronger together.
And we're certainly in the market of making that happen. If there's a willingness within this room and beyond, then we're certainly happy to help to put that together in the early stages just to kick it off.
Councillor Fancy.
Yes, I enjoy your
presentation, and again, like you said, it's a lot of talk, and get all hyped and walk away, and or unhyped, and we go back to our own. If we don't bring things that are sustainable and workable, it will just be talk and a good idea. There's a few things that are, like I think up to, I was at one presentation once where up in Shelburne, they do a lot with the youth. And I think some part of it is getting them to be able to get the social aspect of that. Because without the social aspect, even the young people won't go to work and things like that, because they've always been felt down and out and not, and they've always been isolated, and so then they become falling back more into that poverty type of life, and that's where they'll spend the rest of their life always being a second-rate citizen that will never get out. So I think it's to hit them at that youth. And I always say this, children are cruel because they'll tell you everything they know, or say everything you're gonna say, and they'll be cruel to other people. So they just have a tendency to be that way, you know. But now we all grew up that way. We know what that was like through those years. There's one other thing that we at Social Housing, one time we looked at, and we just never went anywhere with it, was trying to find some single parents with children, trying to raise them with $15 an hour. How are you gonna find rent? If you find rent, you're gonna go without food. And food's going to be the
or heat or whatever.
And there's got to be some way that we can be able to have some kind of a organizational way. And I think there was one in BC where you could be able to plug in what you have, what you want, and then they would charge it to work it. I think it's up in BC they have the program, but I don't know if there's anything in around here locally, where if you get two single moms to meet and be friendly and to know each other, to get into a social meeting where they could share an apartment. Now you cut your expenses down in half. Now you probably provided food for your table. But how do they meet? How do they meet? So there's got to be some type of a program to be able to say, look, I'm starting. I can't live by myself on this. But if we had a two-bedroom apartment or three-bedroom apartment, I could share it with someone. But how do you get to know that? How do you know? And so there's going to be something out there where we can be able to create, if there isn't a program, create a program that we can be able to get these people together so they can be able to make it affordable, because they just can't make it on their own.
And that's where I hope the advocate, if he can come up with a way of funding and, finding, I'm sure we would. I mean, we've met people in the past, at various meetings who have lived experience, who really have taught us what we didn't know before. So these people exist. It's, do we have a way of identifying that person, funding that person, giving that person a job description of what our expectations are? Anyway, that's our presentation.
Councilor
Charles?
Yes, I just have a couple things that I'm thinking of. We allocated money in our budget this year to replace the library. I think there's been some discussions from Councilor Brown has brought forward from the committee that we would like to try to expand, library services so that we'd be more used. So I'm just thinking, that's something that the region has committed to doing. And I think there's all these partnerships at different levels that are already happening. I don't know if everyone is fully aware of them, but my daughter's in pre-primary, and last week they walked to the library, and they went to the library for a couple hours and read books. So, I think people that are well connected in our community. Her pre-primary teacher also sits on the board of Queen's Daycare, so she's involved at the daycare level. To the mayor's comment about the community garden at the daycare, it sort of fell to the wayside for a couple of years, started back up last year. I'm not sure what's ongoing this year, but then the daycare would take their kids over to the community garden, and they would be checking in on the daily growth and things like that. So I think some of these things are already happening. Past councils need a recreation for all programs, so there's funding available for people and children that need it. So I think some of these things have already been happening. My question about what you see, I just thought maybe there was a couple particular things that maybe you had thought from this other that weren't already happening. But I think people are starting to do things, but I think they, as always, they can always improve.
There's a lot of wonderful things going on in different places, but I think bringing it together, compiling it, and really putting it out and having a conversation. It's the awareness, it's having, the conversations can't die. We have to keep those conversations going. And just the things that have been brought up here, that's just wonderful. And we need, like, the community needs to hear about it, the county needs, we need to know about it, everybody. Like, I don't, when we started the conversation, I hadn't had, even as a teacher, we had them all the time, because we faced it every day at school. Since I retired, it's only because I've been a member of the health board or some other committee that I hear about it. But until I joined the committees, the conversations had stopped, and I wasn't hearing a whole lot. And just wondering, where are those conversations? So together again, like bringing it back together and listing them off, and how can you support each other in those, because I'm sure there's other money elsewhere that can support those programs.
Well, and the way I just, this last week or two, we've all been, I'm sure, donating with the Ukraine online auction, which is making a schwack of money. We know that people in Liverpool and around are really very social conscious, you know, they really want to help people. And it just would be nice if we could, you know, we could turn that into ourselves, and what can we do to help our own community? And I'm not suggesting we should stop donating to Ukraine, of course not, but, you know, it's just to say that this is a really generous community. When they see a need, when the community sees a need, they really kick it up a notch. And I would passionately ask, can we do that for our kids living in poverty?
But I also realize what you said is that, too, we've tried many things to bring the people to the table, and we haven't been able to do that, even with the programs. How do we bring people who really need the help? You know, after they've been identified, how? And I think that's part of the difficulty in wanting and being able to do this, provide the program, but getting.
And is it going directly to their home? Is it helping in privacy? Is it teaching how to garden? Is it teaching budgeting? Is it teaching what to buy nutritiously versus others? Is it teaching the importance of drinking water and not flavored juice?
See, I would say it's much more basic than that. I think that's a way up the hill. Right now, when I talk to teachers and they say that kids, particularly over COVID, have not been eating, forget what they've been eating, they're just going to bed hungry, and are not able to participate in activities because they have no money, they have no transport, and they have no access. So I think we have to kind of deal with the bottom first before we talk about how we start cooking meals. We just have to make sure that these kids are getting fed.
Well, teachers were dropping off food bags during COVID because that's the only way they were going to get the food. And I mean, I know we have, you know, breakfast programs, we had a pantry, the kids could come in, get a grocery bag, go pick up their food for the weekend to get them through till payday or whatever it might have been. And honestly, to see them come in, I would just have to leave so that to give them the dignity of being able to pick up that for the weekend. And I mean, they were hungry. So I guess the thing is that not wanting the conversation to die just because we haven't found, like we've tried, everybody tries and we've tried and tried, but there has to be something that we can do.
We can't give up all.
We can't give up, is right. So thank you.
Yeah. Anyway, I thank you. Way back in 2000, I think it was John was mayor at the time, and we actually struck a committee of, well, it was sort of an ad hoc one, and we tried to gather in all the community organizations. We had one meeting. And then it was just so many excuses about, and you really need all the federal partners at the table, you need provincial partners at the table, and you need your non-for-profits at the table. And we've tried and didn't get anywhere. Now, I credit, you know, this is, it's sad statistics, but it's real.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there is humanity around this council chamber.
Oh.
And, you know, honestly, does the Reason Queens have the time and the opportunity at this point in time to kickstart this? But would some counselors willingly engage on behalf of their constituents? Because that's what it takes sometimes, is a knock on someone's door. I just congratulate you on your, because this is hard to deal with, but Barbara, it's important, and Jackie, to find a solution through this.
Yeah.
And I'm sure every counselor here would be willing to talk about how they could help in their district to make connections, to perhaps put you in connection with people.
Well, we certainly, as I mentioned earlier, you know, if that will is there to start the conversation in a really positive way, you know, we would be happy to be part of that partnership to get things going.
And I think if someone started the process, then you may have counselors who wish to take part because they are representative of their communities and they're part of. But I can honestly tell you that right now, and I don't think there's anyone here that would dispute me, as a region of Queens, do we have a staffer or anyone who is capable of taking this project on? I would say we don't at this point in time. But I am certain that as a mayor or as counselors, we could assist you if you called a meeting, if you were interested in further information coming into our districts. I know in Councilor Brown's district, the school feeds people. In Councilor Hawk's district, the North Queens Food Bank is phenomenal in the amount of produce, fresh produce and stuff they're distributing. It's a matter of knowing the people in your community and finding a way to reach them to make them accept the help. And that's the big part, is having people accept the help that's provided.
Yeah, and how does, like, the municipalities in Nova Scotia work together? I don't know that, or if that's a possibility of finding out, like, what is happening. Places that have seen success with increasing, or rather decreasing, the amount of children in poverty. Because it's not just Nova Scotia, it's right across Canada. And I mean, the federal government, over 30 years ago, had stated this, and here we are. So something is not happening.
There is a new structure coming to the NSFM that's going to see us joined with our regional neighbors, so that may offer a form. That will be many months before it's in place, if I have to be wary of the time. So I thank you. I know I see concern expressed by all. And somehow, just keep at it, and we'll reach out and see what counterparts are doing. We get through YMCA or whatever. But really, provincially, federally, Barbara said, you know, single women on welfare, the lowest paid in Canada. But, you know, why?
Yeah.
Exactly. What can our MLA do to assist, you know, poverty, food, children? It's provincial, federal responsibility. We can do our part.
Yeah.
You know, getting through those food rules. You know, I've worked in restaurants. A lot of the food does not go in the garbage. It is reused, it is put back, but they are not allowed to leave it. You know, once it's there, it doesn't go out the door. So those, you know, rules of provincially or whatever, so I thank you.
Thank you.
And,
Thank you. Thank you, appreciate it.
See, I'm gonna hear a completely different, going from poverty to renewable energy. Our CEO says, we have one person called Mitch.
Hi, I'm Dan Roscoe, I'm the managing director of Roswell Development. I think I have that full responsibility, yes. Hi, everyone. My name's Dan Roscoe. I'm managing director of Roswell Development. Mitch and I and our head of finance, Dave, are here today to introduce to you the Mersey River Wind Project. We thank you for the opportunity to present to you today. One of the things that drove us to meet with you today is that we're having a public meeting at Milton Hall tomorrow night, 6 o'clock, where all of this information will be available to the public. We provided more information than we'll be able to get through tonight in this package, but we wanted everyone to have it. And we, this is an introduction. It's going to be a long process, and we're here to answer any questions at the, this is the start of the conversation. We'll talk a little bit as we go through about the various roles and engagement points with the municipality that we'll have drawn along the way. First, we want to acknowledge that we are in Mi'kma'ki, and this project is located in Mi'kma'ki, the unceded territory of the Mi'kma'ki people. Today, we're going to run through quickly. We won't touch on every slide here, but a bit of background about who we are. The renewable to retail program that we're working with, the types of wind turbines, the project site, and the approval process and the work going on. And at the end, we'll talk about the benefits to the community, businesses, individuals, the municipality, and so forth that this project can bring. So at a high level, we're proposing a wind farm on a tract of crown land along the Mersey River that was former land of Bowater Mersey. The parcel of crown land that we've applied for is about 20,000 acres. All of it has been commercially harvested for potentially over 100 years with an existing road network. And part of the attraction that we have is, in addition to the land resources, the access to the transmission system that used to feed the mill that has lots of capacity, and that substation is in Milton. This wind farm is different from every other wind farm that's been done in the province to date in the fact that it will be the first to provide energy into the renewable to retail program. A subsidiary of Roswell was awarded a license by the Utility and Review Board in October to sell clean energy directly to consumers. So this project will help, the power from this project will help Nova Scotians have a choice from whom they purchase electricity from for the first time. Very, very long time. We will be producing obviously 100% local, zero emission electricity. And not only is the electricity clean, but it's we think we can sell it at a lower cost than Nova Scotia Power with more predictability over the long term because of our lack of exposure to fossil fuel prices and carbon prices. A project of this nature can generate significant local benefits, and we'll talk a little bit about those. I'll give you a quick background on our history. Myself, Mitch, and Dave, and a number of others in our organization all worked at a company called Scotian Windfields. For many years, we built projects from Yarmouth to Inverness, the largest of which was the Digby Neck Wind Farm, which was 30 megawatts, and we built 12 other projects. We also were involved mutually in a project in Maine. Since that time, we've started Roswell about 5 years ago to push the envelope further, not only in renewable energy generation, but in the retrofit of facilities, the other side of the meter, if you will, as well as to export our experience. And we're currently working primarily in the Caribbean on renewable energy projects and retrofits as well. The renewables retail program is unique. It was put in place in 2015 within a provincial amendment to the Electricity Act. And we were the first license awarded through that program in 2021. As you can see on the diagram, the Mersey River Wind Project will feed energy to a licensed retail supplier that will be owned and operated by Roswell, and it will also interact with Nova Scotia Power for use of the grid, so that the combination of that two ends up with clean electricity being provided directly to consumers. Those consumers would stop being Nova Scotia Power customers and become become customers of this new entity. We're still going through the process of building out that entity and the infrastructure, even the name and brand and so forth, is going to come likely in the fall, where we will be publicly available and start interacting with customers. We have had substantial conversations with a number of larger customers on the South Shore, kind of commercial and industrial customers, about their power needs, as they will make up a large portion of the first phase of our work. In general, how renewables retail works is that because the cost of electricity from renewable sources, specifically wind turbines in Nova Scotia, has come down to a point where it's actually cheaper than Nova Scotia Power's average cost. The cost of fossil fuels has increased to a point, along with the cost of carbon and other things that are associated with it, that the average cost of wind energy is now less than their cost to generate, the average cost of a kilowatt hour. That's not us saying that, that's from their own integrated resource plan, and that's why they are procuring more renewable energy for the grid in itself, which it would be in addition to this program. What this allows us to do is, because we don't have that exposure to these increasing costs, we can offer lower power rates and more sustainability in that price, because we can actually hedge a large portion of our prices to make sure that the cost won't increase over time. One of the important things that we see in not only providing clean electricity and not, saving energy can help, any customer in Nova Scotia. It's pretty obvious whether it's a not-for-profit or a piece of public infrastructure or a local business. But there's an important economic development aspect, is that the new businesses of our 21st century economy need clean energy to be successful. If you want to open up a data center and provide services to Facebook, you better have clean electricity. You want to make green hydrogen or biofuel or sell organic salmon to Whole Foods. These are all real examples of customers we have, by the way. You need to have a low carbon footprint in order to be in that international market. And I've been exposed to lots of conversations where companies want to come to Nova Scotia, but what kind of answer would they get from Nova Scotia Power when they say, well, we need, 20 megawatts of clean electricity or something like that? They don't have a program as a public utility they can even offer in that regard. So we see, not only is this going to help existing customers, but has the opportunity for local economic development. This is a bit more breakdown on the renewables retail cost. The cost of selling electricity to the customer is a combination of the cost of wind energy, the cost of the tariffs that we have to pay, and our cost for managing, the administration and the marketing metering of that energy. The end result, as I said, that we believe that we can help customers save money in year one. Now, Mitch is going to walk through a few of the details of the project site.
Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present. As Dan said, we're pretty excited to be here to go public with this project we've been working on for a little while. So just very quickly, I'm not going to spend too much time on this. The wind turbines that we're using are much larger. It's kind of the next generation of turbines. So the generating capacity is greater, 4.5 megawatts. The rotor diameter, so that's, blade that's the full diameter, is 150 meters. So each blade would be 74 meters. The last kind of big procurement in Nova Scotia, the biggest turbines right now, have a rotor diameter of 114. So this is, it's just a larger machine, right? So, and this is kind of the new generation. And this is how, the price can go down, is the price per kilowatt of generating wind is basically cheaper for. So with construction, a big part of the impact of the site and what we need is, you know, you basically need roads and lay down areas to support the foundations. And then once those are in place, then you can put the components. They're manufactured around the world. They may not meet until they're actually put together on the site. And so a lot of the work that we need to do to the site is specifically for the construction. And then after they're built, there's relatively little traffic, obviously maintenance crews and, you know, going in there and pick up trucks. Occasionally, maybe a larger repair, but generally speaking, all of the activity on the site happens during the construction phase. So the project site will be located on the tract of Crownland west of Milton. It has been extensively logged, and there's a solid network of access roads on the site. So this is our meteorological test tower that's up there now. This is photos taken by a drone last fall. So here's a site plan, and I think it's in the packages there as well. So we're proposing right now 33 turbines in two phases, and that'll probably get built out over 3 years. The second phase probably broken into two construction phases. But at the end of it, you'll basically have one common site access and one common interconnection to the grid. So the Milton substation is where we're going to interconnect. And the precise route of that, that transmission line going from the project site to the substation is yet to be determined. There's a few factors in that. In our Nova Scotia Power interconnection agreements, they tell us where exactly we can connect. And so, of course, which side of the substation we come in on will depend on that. And then the Crown Land process as well, they've got a number of factors in determining where they would prefer to see the site access and interconnection route. So that's why they're not shown on here. There's a few options that we are investigating, and that's kind of in the process of, you know, going through this bigger picture. So that's in the package there. I'm not sure if it's clear if you have color the two phases, but there's eight turbines in the first phase closer to Milton, and then the other 25 are in behind. And you'll notice all of the roads on this map are existing. So you can see how we're really trying to stick to the existing access roads as much as possible.
How many acres did you take look?
The total parcel?
Yeah.
I think you said 20,000. I forget the number.
Yeah, it's
20,000. Yeah. Now, in the end, the actual impact to the land that we'll need is approximately 1 hectare per turbine, because we will need a lay down area to put the blades and the components, and then a crane pad that will lift them back into place. So just on this, like, you know, we need room for the crane and the components, but the final, you know, the final area that we will need will be just over 33 hectares. Okay, so approvals. Obviously, we will need municipal approval. So that's a development agreement process. And I know that you're going through plan and bylaw review right now. In the draft bylaw, it doesn't look like the wind bylaw changes much. So the idea is that it'll be a development agreement process that will be negotiated. However, because we're on Crown land and do not own the land, we need permission from the Crown before our formal application. So we've had this conversation a little bit with Mike Trenicopa. We've spoken about this. So we need that letter of permission from the Crown to act as agents in the application for the development agreement, which we intend to do. Now, as of right now, because we don't have that, we're doing this presentation and the public engagement we're just to get out in front of it. So there's no formal application, but we just want to make everyone aware that we are working on this. We do intend to, so that no one's blindsided or surprised by the process. So that's why we're starting with this public engagement. Provincial, we will need an environmental assessment. That is underway. More on that later. And our federal NAV and permit, that's all good with aeronautical obstruction. And we need, of course, interconnection agreements for Nova Scotia Power. Quite a few studies. We have a Met tower up there now measuring the wind. That allows us to predict our output from the turbines. There's more information there, but I'll not spend too much time there. So the environmental assessment process, we contracted Strum Consultant, which is a well-known environmental consulting group in the province, so third party, and that's wetland, water course. They also do an avian radar campaign, which is new. So they actually radar out 24 hours a day for a few months at a time to count birds, you know, particularly in migratory windows, to know if we have, you know, we may affect any major migration routes. It will involve a Mi'kmaq ecological knowledge study, archaeological survey, and of course, public engagement. So we've already been working on this since, actually just about a year ago. So we've done visitor tracking surveys, spring public group, water force and wetland delineation, bat monitoring as well. That's another thing that we need to watch out for. Lichens and rare flora, so if there's any impact on land, we need to kind of move around. So the site plan that you see now is after a lot of this field work is complete. So we've, you know, our initial thoughts, we moved things around a little bit to avoid any impact areas that we found from our completed field work. We're not done yet, so we're still working. There's avian radar on the site right now. There's still, you know, acoustic monitoring as well. There's some wetland and water course delineation for some of the proposed access routes to the Crown that's kind of in discussion. Fish habitat, turtles, eastern rivers, ribbon snakes, and other kind of wildlife stuff that's still ongoing, but we have enough understanding of the site to know where the risk areas are. So some of the biggest impact to people will be shadow and sound. So you can model that initially. So the shadow modeling, that means like a flicker is whenever the blade passes in front of the sun, and between you and the sun, I should say, and that creates a shadow for a moment, which can be annoying. Just like when you're driving in a car when there's trees going by, it's the same thing. So this is a model that shows the number of hours per year that the shadow flicker will fall on a given area. And so to do this model, they've got topography, but they assume a few things. The assumption is that there's no vegetation, right? So it assumes like no trees at all, which obviously isn't true. It assumes that it's always sunny and that it's always windy. Because if it's not sunny and windy at the same time, you won't get that shadow flicker. So this model is basically the maximum potential human impact. And if you look kind of along the river, and like Milton is just off to the right on that map there, we don't really hit any homes, right? The idea is that we're back in the woods away to basically not bother people. The other modeling is sound modeling. This is obviously an item of concern for a lot of people. So the sound that's emitted by wind turbines is not different from anything else. It's just the blades that move through the air, and it does create sound. And of course, that sound gets carried on the wind, particularly downwind, right? So this model assumes the sound level created by the turning blades. And again, this model assumes there's no vegetation, that it's always windy, and that everywhere is downwind. And what I mean by that is it's like the maximum extent in any direction that the sound may carry. So that's what these blobs mean. And so you'll notice on the right, it might be more clear in your handout, it's the legend of your decibels, so how loud it is. And A-weighted decibels means how loud we perceive it to be, which is kind of the important thing. And I put this little chart in here just to show you that, you know, 35 decibels is very, very quiet. Low speed at like 1 meter distance, and you'll see that where it gets outside near the river and near any potential receptors, it's down to that level. The other thing I should mention in this model is it doesn't assume any ambient noise. So if you're next to a river that just has a bubbling creek, you're I don't know exactly how many decibels that is, but it means that you wouldn't hear anything quieter than that. So the takeaway from this is you can look to see where the receptors are, particularly over by Milton, and you know anything below 35 decibels is really not worth monitoring because you'll never hear it anyway. So the idea is that we're back in the woods far enough away to avoid some of the troublesome impacts that people receive from wind turbines.
I'll go through the community benefits. So there's two, wind farms in general have a number of benefits for the community. But as we will also be a retailer of electricity, we have more options in how we can have local benefits than a typical wind farm would have. So we've taken on a number of things, commitments in the development of this project. The first which be the creation of a community dividend. This is something we've done on previous projects where we set aside funds for investment into local community initiatives. Sure, you hear about a number of them, and it's something that we've done in other projects throughout Nova Scotia. Priority access to our renewable to retail programs. You can imagine if we're going to sell electricity at a lower rate, that our interest will be significant. We want to give people from Queenstown the opportunity to have first crack at that. We also interested in creating a not-for-profit energy rate that can help community entities that are doing particular community services or benefits to have a preferential, if you will, energy rate. We hear all, there's always, once a month it seems like there's a story somewhere in Nova Scotia of a farmer's market or another entity that's trying to provide, whether it's social housing or some kind of community service that is struggling with higher energy costs. One of our approaches to this is not only being able to sell clean energy, but help to retrofit the buildings to be able to be a clean and flexible consumer of electricity. So switching out boilers for heat pumps and things like that to help make them more electrical, which also helps save money. So these are things that we'd like to investigate further on the community side. More traditional economic benefits, we'll have over 100 people employed temporarily under the construction, with 6 to 12 full-time employees as we grow the wind farm. From a municipal tax revenue, something that you may or may not be interested in, taxes are regulated provincially at a rate that's roughly almost $8,000 a megawatt. So if we build out this project in full, we'll represent over $1 million in municipal tax revenue for the region of Queens. The last thing I wanted to highlight again under the community benefits, because I know this conversation has already come up, is the attraction of local businesses that want clean electricity to Queens County. Obviously, the former industrial lands that of Bowater are of interest, and the opportunity to do things like hydrogen or bioenergy or other energy-intensive things that need clean energy, the opportunity to bring that here to Nova Scotia in general and to Queens County specifically, we think is a real a big driver for this program, not only here but throughout the province. Next steps, as Mitch said, we're working with the Crown process to get that letter of agency so that we can apply for our development agreement. We've just updated our development plan with them to include all of our environmental work that we've done. So that's in the process, and we hope to get that in the next few months. We will submit our environmental assessment at some point in the summer. I think it's looking like August right now, where we'll end up submitting our environmental assessment for approval. And the interconnection process is underway through this year as well. So our target is to have all permits lined up by the end of the year. That allows us to buy wind turbines, put the orders on. We need about a 12-month process before they arrive, and at least another 3 months to get them up and running after that point. During that period, which will be mostly 2023, we will be building roads, power lines, and so forth to get their site ready, foundations. The local concrete companies will be happy with us because there's a lot of concrete in each one. But that work will go under 2023. We hope to be able to sell power by the end of 2023. Time frames and so forth are tough to predict these days, but that's the time frame we're working on. I think that's all we have. We welcome any questions.
Just before I ask your questions, what time is your meeting tomorrow evening?
6 p.m. Milton Hall.
Yeah. And it's an open drop-in session, so 6
p.m. Oh, it's a drop-in.
It's a drop-in. It's an open house style, 6 to 8. We'll have all of this information essentially in poster board form. I think we're going to have about 8 people there from our team, 2 or 3 from our environmental team, and the rest from our own team.
Questions? Yes. Brown.
You're starting off your first phase was 8 turbines, was it?
That's correct, yeah.
They'll probably be in that corner closest to Nova Scotia Power's depot?
That's correct. Yeah. We'll back to the slide here, yeah. It'll be the 8 easternmost turbines. The substation is the small black and yellow lightning bolt that's on the other side of the river. And the first 8 turbines as you come up the hill, there's 2 rows of 4 there, that would be phase 1.
Probably a laser pointer on the end of that.
Oh, wow. I don't know if I can do that. Yeah, look at that. Those 8 right there. So those would be the first ones. As Mitch said, these roads are all existing. Our Met Tower is right there. And they'll be the first ones. Right now, we've received interest from commercial industrial clients that is greater than phase 1. So we hope to be able to move forward with at least part of phase 2 in the near future as well.
Good questions. Councillor Charlton.
I just like to comment that that was a great presentation. It was really enlightening, all of your objectives, and thank you.
You're very welcome. Mitch and I have done this about 100 times. I think public meetings in 13 different projects in Nova Scotia, so practice.
Comes across as polished, but not jaded.
Thank you very much.
Councilor Fancy?
I'm the councilor for that area.
You're aware, yes.
Oh, you're aware.
We also know you're a power engineer with Bow Water, so you probably know more about this.
You've been around.
Yeah.
Just two things, like I've had a lot of, talking back and forth with some of the other people who had turbines and this wind turbines, and it's, you know, not always pretty when it comes through. Because of like the follow-up in Truro, who, so they're just on the border of where they need to be. And I forget now the distance, I'd have to look back up.
Yep.
We'll talk more about that tomorrow night, things. But there was, he has a lot of problem with the shadowing. Mm-hmm. And they said that low, the noise from the turbines sometimes can give a low hum, and it drives him crazy up there. Because what's the distance that the closest housing is going to be?
I think there's a few, one or two cottages and some buildings of Nova Scotia Power that are the closest, but the full-time resident, we're over 2 kilometers, I believe, which I think is, this site, I mean, one of the nice things about this site, it is definitely far from houses.
Not to do it then.
Yeah, the list, and I think the strictest as of right bylaw has a 1,000 meter setback in Nova Scotia. So that's what we use in our, when we do a prospecting and constraints analysis, we start with that. Mm-hmm. What are the areas that are 1,000 meters back, and we're 2,000 plus for this project. There's also the terrain and forestry difference that I think will make a big difference as well.
The other thing is that we've had other presentations before, and they were waiting for a license.
Right.
Because there's only so many licenses out to get. We've already got your license.
Yeah, there's a distinct difference. Every other wind farm that's been proposed, and you've heard them in Shelburne, you've heard them elsewhere, they're all bidding into a process with Nova Scotia Power.
Right.
With us, we have our license. We have to get permits. But really, we're selling the energy to clients. We need to sign up off-takers. But we're confident in that, and we have most of it spoken for already. So we're investing the money to move the project forward based on that. One of the things we will want to do over the next 6 months is solidify that. But we have a lot of interest from big kind of commercial, industrial, I'll say creditworthy off-takers. You know, big energy users, including Freeman Lumber here in Queens. As well as another mill in Chester, we've spoken to a number of companies in Halifax that are of interest. A lot of our work actually started with Killam Properties in Halifax. They wanted to secure clean energy for their apartment buildings. We've also spoken to Clearwater, Acadian Sea Plants, and Irving. So there's a lot of interest of big consumers that some of them have, want to reduce costs. Some of them have a corporate target to be clean by a certain time. Obviously, there's a number of other players that we can talk to as well once we start. But that's our deliverable to check. But we're confident in our model that we'll be able to provide them. So far, no one said no yet, put it that way.
And so this is going to be offered to like Queens County, Queens County residents, others,
yep.
And us, so we get a, not a special rate, but get a first chance.
That's right. We want to have, we call it priority access. We're going to have a lot of demand for these products, and we want to make sure that, Queens County residents and businesses have an opportunity to benefit. We can sell energy anywhere in the province, and we will offer our services to anyone in the province, but we want to have, I think it's important that Queens County gets an opportunity to have first crack.
And just one last question. Are we buying power or are we buying turbines?
No, we would be selling energy per kilowatt hour in a very similar fashion to you currently buy it. We would look for a longer term contract. So it's much more like a cell phone contract, I think, that you want to commit for certain years to pay a certain rate for energy over that period.
Yeah, because that sounds
Because when you're buying the turbine, you could buy the whole shoot match.
No, we're ultimately, you know, developing. We have partners that, you know, to build and develop and finance the wind farm. We're simply selling energy. And, you know, we are keen to talk to the municipality about your energy needs as well.
Right.
You know, water treatment, I would suspect, would be top among the list of users.
Queen's Place.
Yeah, Queen's Place. Yes. So, yeah, those are things that we'd like to talk to as well.
Okay, thank you.
Deputy Mayor Muse?
So, your sound model, did you do it with the new, let's say, your windmills are going to be bigger?
The actual wind turbine model that we're planning on using right now gets put into that, and it's Strum, our third party provider, who does the analysis for us.
So I got some questions from some of the guys that do some hunting and fishing up in that area. Mm-hmm. Are you going to be blocking that off?
We're just leasing a small piece of land from the Crown. I don't think the Crown would plan to, you know what the Crown does with the rest of the land is still up to them. We'll be making the roads up there nicer, and we won't have, you know, restrictions on access from our perspective.
Deputy Mayor Muse?
How are you going to, like, say, if I wanted to, my residence, to buy the power from the wind turbines, how do I know it's coming from?
Well, you'll get a bill from us saying that we're selling you energy. There'll be a point where you'll have to request to change your service provider, just like you're changing your, you know, your TV provider or your phone provider. I think the changing from Belt and bringing on Eastlink is a very simple thing. That's the most similar situation that you have in Nova Scotia, of breaking an existing monopoly and a new player coming in. It would be no different than you changing, you know, TV or cell phone or anything.
But it's not always, the power comes to my house, won't always be coming from the windmills.
Because the wind turbines will be variable, but all of the renewable, all of the energy that will be sold to you will be renewable, and we have to make sure that we're putting on a surplus of renewable energy onto the grid so that our customers can say they're getting 100% renewable energy. Part of the renewable to retail program is that retail access is only offered if you're providing 100% renewable product. We will look at things like energy storage, batteries, hydrogen, and very interested in opportunities behind the meter to provide flexibility so that you can better align our use with the generation. Also, wind energy is very much aligned with our energy use in Nova Scotia. We use far more energy in the winter where it's windier, so there's a good alignment. You know, generally it's colder in the winter, it's windier in the winter, so there's a good alignment there between energy usage on a kind of month-by-month basis.
Any other questions? Gia McNeil.
I guess just curious about your involvement discussions with Acadia First Nations. Obviously, there's a lot of jobs being created at the start for temporary full-time jobs. Wondering if you have any discussions with them and commitments for Indigenous employment or Big Maw employment as well. I know there are a number of special places up there that would be important for the Big Maw people. And have you had discussions with them about protecting those areas?
Yes. So I'll answer your first question. Last question first, which would be we'll conduct a Mi'kmaq ecological knowledge study, which will identify those areas. Demand for those types of services are quite constrained right now with respect to all the other wind farms that have been proposed right now. So we're in the queue for that service this summer. We're also working with Acadia. We've spoken with them both on the community engagement side, on the economic development side, as well as partnership opportunities that we're open to. We don't have any definitive agreements in place with them, but we have we've spoken with them 3 or 4 times already, and the door is open for the input and direct involvement in the project.
Any one more question?
Okay, I just got one quick question.
Councilor Fancy?
Would you ever consider, I look at housing as a serious issue all the way around. You say you want to put back into the community.
Yep.
Would that ever be something you consider, maybe even for your own employees and for others, rather, because the housing
we? Do you consider building something?
We're very interested. We've actually spoken with one or two people that are interested in, I'll call small housing developments here. The energy needs of housing and how do you, affordable housing, energy poverty associated with low-income housing. It's something we, as a group, have a lot of experience with. Dave, who's our head of finance, David Howell, he's actually involved with the home builder as his quote-unquote day job. And often even, in places that we're looking at internationally, housing is an issue. How do you develop this? So we're very interested in supporting that and identifying and can work to collaborate on the needs. We're keenly interested. I've also worked, spent 3 years working with the Verschuren Center in Cape Breton, where housing is a huge need, energy poverty. There's still hundreds of homes in Cape Breton that use coal for heating.
Oh, yes.
As part of pensions it's a real problem to break that cycle but housing is an area, affordable housing, and there's a significant amount of jobs available in retrofitting. Retrofitting homes, insulating them, changing out heat pumps, upgrading electrical services and things like that. I think that's where finance retrofit models can really help stimulate the local economy, but also help provide more cost-effective housing. So it's a topic that we're very interested in. We'd love to talk more about it.
Okay.
And on that note, I wish you well. Meeting
tomorrow, and we look forward to the day when you can provide lesser cost clean energy to, we have year-round tourism operators, we have hospital, we have Queen's Place, we have Freeman's Mill, we have many places, especially business-wise, as well as homeowners. I think of the curling clubs, we have lots of energy users. And you'll be producing that much, and we only need that much.
Yeah, we ultimately, this site, under its full production, will produce about 5% of the energy needs for Nova Scotia, electricity needs. So
you could feed all of Queens County.
Probably, yes.
We look forward to that day. And we'll see you again, and good luck tomorrow night.
Thank you very much. Look forward to seeing some of you tomorrow night at our meeting.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mitch, what's your last name?
Underhay. Yes.
Okay. Any petitions? 4.0. Do you have any petitions?
Thank you.
The opportunity.
No petitions to table? No one in our gallery to ask public questions, comments. Approval of the minutes. Regular council, May 10th, 2022. Moved by Councilor Brown, seconded by Councilor Gidney. All those in favor? Minutes of approval of the public hearing minutes, May 17th, 2022. Moved by Councilor Charlton. Seconded by Councilor Romero. Any questions? All those in favor? Passed. Recommendations 7.1. Levy, Municipal Clerk, University Coordinator. This was is presented as a recommendation, as this was part of our discussion at our last meeting. So there is a recommendation within the package. Councilor Charlton.
I move that the Council of Region of Queens Municipality approve revised policy 23 respecting regular meetings of council.
Seconded by Councilor Hawks and Mr. Levy.
Yeah, so as in your package has indicated that in our last discussion on May 10th, there have been some amendments proposed in policy 23 respecting regular meetings of council. The primary changes are in sections 4 and 5, where section 4, the meeting to be held in North Queens, has been proposed to be moved to June. I contacted the North Queens High School. It doesn't conflict with any of their graduation events for this year. And also section 5, no meetings the fourth Tuesday of July or August.
Any questions?
Yes, I just have a quick question to both the clerk and her CAO. If we had to hold an emergency meeting, should it say no regular council meeting?
Policy meeting, regular meetings.
Regular meetings, right. So you could still hold an emergency or special council meeting on that date. Didn't coordinate the title. Any other comments or complaints? I'm going to ask for a question. All those in favor? Contrary? Pass.
Great, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
7.2, there is a note within your recommendation within the package. Councillor Gibney?
I move that the Council of Regional Queens Municipality agrees to waive policy 58, consumption of alcohol on municipally owned property at the request of private farmers markets at Denver Park, Liverpool on Saturdays from June the 4th to December 31st, 2022. And that the applicant be required to submit proof of insurance of no less than $2 million per occurrence, with the Region of Queens Municipality as additional insured, and a copy of the in effect liquor license from the province of Nova Scotia to the region, and that all municipal, provincial, and federal laws be strictly adhered to.
Councillor Gidney, and that's seconded by Councillor Rubin. Any questions regarding the wavering of this? Councillor Charlton?
Is this something that has to come back to council every single time? I'm just thinking if there has to be a policy. Okay. Just thinking where they're always standing and they're always usually running for the same period of time. I just, okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? I'll ask for the question. All those in favor? Contrary? Pass. Director Brett, just wave the table, please. Is a recommendation. Yes, within the package. Councillor Hawks.
I move that the Council of Regional Queens Municipality approve the rebuild of the 2010 CAT 826H landfill compactor at a cost of $688,173 plus HST, with the cost being funded through the withdrawal from the landfill equipment reserve.
Thank you. Seconded by Councilor Fancy. And as we know, we budgeted this, but Director Grant, you can just give us a little bit of detail at the final price.
Yes, over the last couple of years, we've been working with Tormach CAT towards this. Originally, it was the replacement of the machine, but as you can see from the report now, the replacement cost is extreme. Conditions, and they urged us and convinced us, I guess, to look at another option, which is a certified powertrain rebuild, which is another form of maintenance upkeep. There's other jurisdictions out there that have done 3 and 4 of these consecutively and still have fully functioning, you know, great working machines, so certainly a great cost-saving alternative. Initially, I guess, in discussion, we hadn't anticipated the wheels being in the condition they are, but through the TA2, they discovered that the wheels are severely worn and definitely need to be rebuilt at this time, or facing, you know, certain failure in the immediate future.
Right, and this certified rebuild is good for 6,000 hours or 60 months?
That's right, so it would extend the warranty and beyond that. I mean, we'll be on the hook for it, but at this point, I would expect that with this rebuild, we should be good for another 8 to 10 years with the same machine and be looking at the probably similar option come that time.
Any questions of Director Grant? Councilor Brown.
You said that a couple of other jurisdictions have done this sort of a rebuild on them and been quite successful?
That's right. Guysboro in particular had done 3 or 4. They thought it was 4, but and then at the same time, they weren't sure. Chester has done at least 1. There is other options where you can do a full rebuild at like about $1.1 million. So there's some savings there, and that generates a new serial number and all that stuff. With the amount of hours it's on the machine, they told us it wouldn't be worth our while. Yeah, there's certainly lots of other people out there that are doing the same thing, the same way.
Any other questions? I'm going to ask for the question. All those in favor? Contrary? Pass.
Council of Regional Queens Municipality gives second reading to a revised municipal planning strategy and land use bylaw, and that the documents be forwarded to Nova Scotia Municipal Affairs and Housing for ministerial approval.
And then seconded by Councilor Fox. So, Director McLeod, just a brief update. We've been through this and comments you would like to make.
No real new comments, I guess just as a brief overview. We've been at the process of preparation of the revised planning strategy and land use bylaw for well over 3 years now. The project has been very detailed as far as public engagement. The processes that were undertaken by Upland Planning being our consultant. It was comprehensive stakeholder engagement throughout the duration of the project, preparation of the detailed background papers on, I guess, the current status of Queens County, policy direction papers, several iterations of draft documents were prepared, the final draft being completed in February of 2021. The documents were brought forward for first reading in February. Since that time, there have been three public hearings held to gather input from the public on the draft documents. The recent being held on May 17th. So I think we're at the stage now for council.
Questions or comments? Councilor Fancy.
It has been a long process. Started off, before COVID, when we got through COVID, which has changed things very considerably. It's made a lot of people either happy or uncomfortable. I still think there's a lot of in there that's still a concern to me, and I'm not ready to approve it at this time.
Councilor Charlton?
I do have some concerns, however, I intend to support the second reading because this is a living document and one that can be amended. And I recently discovered that in the Hamlet Zone, someone wouldn't be able to put a greenhouse in what was considered the front yard, even if they had 400 feet. So I don't personally believe that this document is at a point where it should be set back. There are developments being held up where we're sitting right now. But in saying that, I do understand that there are some concerns, which I have mentioned before, and to our director of planning. So I do intend to support it, but I think that we as a council should be having more conversations, particularly about food insecurity. I mean, we just had that presentation with the poverty and children in Queens. And, I think our staff did the best that they could with public engagement and engaging people that wanted to be engaged at the time. Some people weren't aware of everything. And I think in the recent, even maybe 6 months with the cost of groceries, people are now afraid and are paying more attention and they're thinking, how can I try to provide for my family better? So I personally think that we can have some discussions and educate ourselves more. And maybe I think if we could look at having someone with agriculture experience have a seat on our planning advisory committee, standing, I think that those are things that we could improve to move forward. But I don't think that the document is bad.
I have the same feeling as Councilor Charlton. I reviewed it, and I believe that there's still some things that we haven't addressed that can be addressed. However, I'm on the same that we cannot have everything done, and I think we should move along. Or my thought is to move along with this, and then
when changes come up and discussions come up with residents, that we can look at it on a more individual basis, and maybe that's not the correct word, but and work from there. So I think it's time to move on, and that I agree that we should proceed with this.
Councilor Rao?
Yeah, I know there's been a lot of negative about this in social media, but I think that's a smaller number of people who are very engaged, and it's good to see people engaged in the process because they pointed out things to us. But I've also been through the community and talked to a large number of residents in the community who also took the time to read the document and are very happy with where we are with it now. So I think for me, from my experience in talking with the community, the vast number of people I talk to are in favor of the document going forward.
Any other comments? Councilor Fox?
I think that maybe, yeah, I'd like to see maybe yearly, just to see what we can make an amendments to what issues come up once a year, once every 6 months, whatever, right? But just because there will be issues come up, and we should just plan on pigeonholing and say, this is when we do it.
Any other comments?
I have a problem with.
Deputy Mayor, I am going.
Your vote.
Okay, never mind. You go.
I can't vote on it, but I'm going to speak on it. No?
Can't vote, can't speak. That's up to you, what you decide to do.
Okay, I'll do it.
Councilor Fancy, because I'm known to have the chair over to you, because I just want to have the last words. So you're going to have to call for the vote. I thought about what we've been hearing, and I realized that this document protects rural values. I spoke to Ian Watson after the last public hearing, and he said the committee actually heard from people living in rural areas like Western Head and Mersey Point, who didn't want farms and who didn't want forestry. What this document does is it protects rural values in our rural areas. It says, yes, you can have intensive farming. Yes, you can have wholesale livestock. Yes, you can have forestry uses. So it protects us in our rural values. So I am definitely supporting this document. It's a living document. If we notice things coming astray, we can correct them. But people are, we right now we're sitting in between, and we will never please everyone, no matter what we do. And I believe this is the best that we have at this time to put forward to the citizens' points. So I will definitely support this document.
Okay, is there anybody else who has a final comment before we vote?
I'll support this document as well, but I do think there is some changes that does need to be made, and I'll look forward to what we can do about it.
Any other comments? Just no more comments? All in favor? Contrary minded? Passed.
Thank you. Director Brandt, we're back to the table again. There is a recommendation in our package respecting a 2022 flat excavator purchase. Someone wants to make that recommendation. Councilor Charlton.
I move that the Council of Region of Queens Municipality approve the purchase of the 2022 PC238USLC-11 excavator with extended warranty and trade-in of a 1991 Caterpillar 215 excavator at a price of $310,000 plus HST to be funded from the equipment reserve.
And that's seconded by Councilor Romero.
Again, this was a budgeted item.
That's right, so it's a budgeted item, we went into the market to three Nova Scotia-based equipment providers and suppliers for provision of proposals. One didn't respond, the other two both responded with decent proposals. There's no real difference other than the price and the trading value. We came down to the lowest proposed price of $310 for most of the equipment. The machine is more or less a direct replacement for a 31-year-old piece of equipment that is severe amount of hours, more than 20,000, which is unlikely in any use. So it's well in need to be replaced or something.
Any questions, Director
Grant?
Councilor Gidney.
What is the value? What was the value of the 1991? But what you get for trading? I'm just very.
So Wilson's offered us, I believe, was 15,000. The other company offered 24.
Thank you.
Councilor Charlton.
Is it typical when these submissions go out that one or more don't respond?
In talking around with different contractors, Brandt has moved out of the government focus and that kind of lens, and they're looking just at the private market right now. I did speak with their sales rep, and he asked for coming down, and never heard no more from him. So why he didn't provide a proposal, I guess.
I'm just curious. Thank you.
It's not unusual in today's market. Availability of machines is very limited, so I wasn't really surprised.
Any other questions? If not, all those in favor? Contrary? Passed. 7.6 Road Naomi Lavender Cove Road.
I move that the Council of the Region of Queens Municipality approve the naming of existing driveway of Highway 3 and Port Tomb as Lavender Cove Road.
And that's seconded by Councilor Brown. We heard about this in our discussion point. Are there any further questions of Director McLeod? If not, I'm going to ask for the question. All those in favor? Passed. 7.7. Director Vino. This came to the recommendation as it came from a committee with a motion, and hence we find it as a recommendation rather than discussion because it had already been through a committee for discussion and recommendation. So would Councilor Charlton, who sits on the Audit and Internal Committee.
I move that the Council of the Region of Queens Municipality authorize evaluation allowance for taxes receivable of $161,313.84 for the fiscal year 2021-2022.
And that's seconded by Councilor Brown, who also sits on the committee.
So I don't know if you all remember last year, but we had some issues with evaluation allowance. There was some subjectivity in there, so our staff worked very hard to create a policy that had a specific methodology that would take the subjectivity out of whatever went into the allowance. And it also ties into the new accounts receivable collections policy that we brought to council for their approval. So what will happen now, the timing is fine, so that as soon as an account becomes arrears such that it becomes part of the valuation allowance, it's then on kind of the agenda for the next tax sale. So it's just part now of an ongoing process. And again, I'll remind you that even though you see the evaluation allowance is $161,000, that doesn't mean that's the expense. The expense is actually $79,000, and that doesn't include the tax recovery, because remember now we don't net everything out together, we do things separately. That doesn't include the tax recovery that will be on this year's financial statement of $162,000. So our collections have grown by leaps and bounds over the last 18 months. We're doing the staff's doing a very good job. Any questions? I'll ask for the question. All those in favor? Contrary? Passed. Liverpool Business Development Center and Director Grant. You might as well join Director Vino at the table. So we're back to
Vino offered to provide the tables that you see within the agenda, showing various levels of financing, and this is assuming that the leases that are currently in are not released, because we can't assume those things.
Well, we have two scenarios that are presented. One scenario with the existing leases continuing, and then one with the existing leases ending.
Right, and it's, either way, they're there.
They are.
Large numbers. So where should the discussion begin?
Do you want me to just go over the report? Just talk, go through it? Over the, no? Okay.
Nothing can help, isn't it?
Nothing, we've all seen the numbers, and, I mean, there's always, this isn't any way of not influencing anyone, but there's always the choice of hold our breath and hope it stays together, and have a contingency plan in case it doesn't. Councilor Romero?
Did you speak to Goldman Empire about splitting up?
We looked at it. At this point, I don't think there's going to be any impact whatsoever to your, the Western, the laws, what they speak of in the report. Was all like about T-bar work that needs to be done. Mm-hmm. That's our, my understanding and their expectation on that. So, to be no impact to the force pieces that exist.
So, we matter if we look at them.
That's right.
Okay.
I must be way over the line here, but we're looking at building the library, and it's going to cost us $3 million. So if I can't afford the truck that I have now, I don't think I'm going to go and buy a truck that's better. So I'm really lost in why we'll be spending the money and not taking the money that we have and putting into this heating system and holding up in the library. I got a few calls about this. And people saying, you know, if we can't afford what we have now, why are we going to start building more stuff? Listen to the constituents.
Councilor Charlton?
But who said we can't afford it? Because we have options for financing, right? I just think these are, I understand what Deputy Mayor Muse is saying, but these are two different things. So if that building was empty right now, then it would be a different conversation, but it's not empty, and there's about 100 jobs there, I think. And the library serves a different purpose, in which it provides supports for people in our community who need them. I think children specifically to that poverty presentation. So I realize it's a lot of money, but we do have options to get it. It's not gonna put us in a negative situation, particularly. It's my understanding. Like financially, I mean, I know we can drain reserve if that wanted to happen, but we have options to long-term borrow where it could potentially affect taxpayers minimally, or am I off base?
Councilor Grant, she's disrupted.
On what?
The white one behind it. I don't quite remote. Behind the left.
So, to your point, Councilor Charlton, what I wanted to do when I made these schedules was to put in the net amount at the bottom that it was going to cost. So right now, a penny on the tax rate is about $100,000, give or take. So, you know, if you look at that, it's going to cost, you know, between 4 and 5 cents if we lose the tenants I think between 2 and 3 cents if we don't. Yeah. So the taxpayers are going to be subsidizing that call center. And yes, you're right, we do have options for financing, but you know, we only have so much in a surplus. We've committed our surplus for this year. I think one of the things that stood out to me when I did the schedules was the way that the debt works. You notice that we don't actually start paying anything back till 2025, because the way it works with municipal borrowing is the project has to be 110% completed before we go to the MFC to get a debenture, and then it's on the next debenture release. So you're looking at, you know, a span of 3 years before that starts to hit the tax rate, which is a way out. You know, so you have to, you know, consider that in terms of a legacy of what the council will be leaving. And I'm not trying to steer you either way. I just want to make sure that I communicate the information that I gathered, and with the help of Director Grant, we had a conversation regarding the additional things that need to be done above and beyond the $2 million, which I think I put in the report. That all of those things have to be considered when you're making your decisions.
So Director Grant, what if we do not?
It's like in, it's a matter of time, and it will fail, and we won't get parks for it. I mean, it's not the scare tactic, it's reality. Nothing was built to last forever that I'm aware of, so at some point it's going to fail, and we're going to be in a hard place trying to find an alternative temporary solution and waiting for a permanent one. When that is, I have no idea. Like everything else right now, it just seems like parks every day get more and more scarce.
Looking at it on paper,
Mayor Horn, if I may, staff were asked to come back with options for costing it. Staff did not analyze if we didn't cost it or if we didn't do anything. We just came back with costings for doing it. So I think it's, you know, staff are not in a position here today that we can answer what we would do, because we haven't analyzed all the options. We've only analyzed what it would cost if you financed it yourself through different mechanisms.
Are there other options?
Lots of other options.
So should we direct staff to look at other options, if there's other options? I mean, I don't know what any other options would be, but if there are other options, rather than fixing it, then said, well, if we don't fix it, then could we have a plan in place if and when it failed? It's 18 months. We started yesterday, or 18 months before, and that's a good time frame before it be finished.
That
would only put about,
that's a good expectation right now.
18 months. And that leaves a year and a half on the lease.
I can certainly talk with CAO McNeil, and he can give me suggestions, and I can come back to council with some other options once I'm, you know, comfortable with what you are looking at and what CAO McNeil has in mind.
I'm not worried about the money that we put into it thus far, because it's paid for itself.
On order. Are we looking at financing options here? I don't really think there's no other options on the table right now, so why don't we discuss this first? I'm a little lost.
I've sat here and no one has said anything, and I've waited in silence for people to speak.
you're supposed to pass the meeting over to me.
And no one spoke. So if you'd like to speak, here's your chance.
Well. I think we have to look back at the findings.
Counselor Gidney.
Correct me if I'm wrong on this. When I look at it, if we buy the unit and everything goes according and everything stays good and everything's working, it's going to cost us 4 to 5 cents tax rate.
If everything goes well and the lease continues, it's going to cost you between 2 and 3 cents at today's pricing on the tax rate.
Right.
But I didn't, you know, I built in a small increase to power bills and things like that. But
right.
It's hard to really estimate 10 years out because that's what the debentures have to be repaid.
No, and I understand
yeah.
that. So if we do it, either way, we're still losing money. Is that correct? Like, there's no win here. I mean, the win here is the employees, but I mean, there's no win out of our coffers. Like, we're losing money on this.
That is correct.
Okay.
That is correct. But that these are not, as CIO McNeil said, this is what I interpreted as your ask was.
No, and that's what I'm saying. I'm saying
but
on
there
this.
Are,
I'm, just,
there
I'm not
are,
going anywhere else.
Probably other options.
Yes.
So, you know, if that's something that you want to discuss, I'm sure CAO McNeil and I can put something together for the next meeting.
Councilor Charlton?
Councilor Gidney's point about how much it was costing if it was rented. Weren't we losing 1 to 2 cents on it when it sat empty? Based off just general maintenance costs, right? Wanted to note that because
well when it was empty we also paid 1 cent was taxes because we lost them, we had to pay ourselves, right?
Mm-hmm. Councilor Fancy.
The other variable in this is that we have contracts, but if for some reason if we let it go and it ran for a year or two and we were happy and everybody was, that would be the best case scenario. But it also broke down, what's our responsibility as a region?
As a landlord, you mean?
Yeah, as a landlord.
From an occupational health and safety perspective, going back to the incident 8 years ago, we were in a serious compromise position trying to operate a facility that didn't have adequate air supply. And that was kind of the point that got to when the paralegal stepped in and forced our hand to use alternative means to cool the facility at that time. So that, I guess, is our liability.
So that's where you said you could get rentals.
At that time, we did.
So we could have that as a backup just going forward and running it as did.
It's certainly possible. I believe at that time we had something like 8 units. A couple of came from Toronto, a couple from Montreal, from all over, you know, this eastern part of Canada, and it didn't happen overnight to get in place. So times have changed. Will people tolerate that a couple of years from now? To wait a week, 2 weeks to put that in place? I can't speak to that. So certainly a risk.
Everybody's looking at options.
What
kind of cost was associated with that?
I'd have to go back and look at it. I honestly can't remember now whether that cost today is still applicable or not, or how much it's increased. I'm not sure.
Anyone want to speak before I recognize Councilor Charlton again?
So there was, we talked before about potentially being sold, that would include an appraisal, but to me, I think regardless of whether we wanted to sell it or not, I think we still have to initiate somewhat of the process. I mean, I'm just hanging on to the occupational health and safety and that liability, which was mentioned by Dr. Brandt. So just to clarify, because I'm not really sure where this conversation is going, or if you have to have options brought back, like, does that look like we initiate the planning process and potentially get an appraisal and see where we stand? I mean, I know we can't get all, we can't recoup all that money that we spent on it regardless, but I mean, you asked if there are other options, or CAO said yes, so I'm just wondering, I guess, what does that look like us saying right now we need to see those other options and then this conversation picks up next time? I just don't want to waste anybody's time, so.
So in discussions before, and you said that the building is last 30 to 50 years of critical maintenance. It's not, none of this is, I mean, the heating system, sure, maybe it should have been done a little different when it was built, but, you know, once we have put the four different units on there, I think, you know, the building's going to last 30 to 40 years. I think for economic development, we should look at something else. I mean, it's going to cost us money. You know, like I said, it was costing us money when it was sitting there empty. At least now we got a contract for a while.
Councilor Merrill had her hand up.
It is going to cost us money. It's a big decision to make. I just wish we would have been aware of it before we reduced the tax rate. Because we may not have reduced it by so much, and it might have helped out, but I would like to know what CAO had in mind, though, as far as other options as well.
That was just my comment. I sort of asked a question, and I just wasn't sure where we were going here. Like, if we want, they mentioned there's lots of other options, so does that need to come back? Because I think they can't prepare it all in a report for us right now, obviously. But what does that, what are our options?
Are you ready to express any other options?
Oh, the staff haven't had a chance to look at the other options. Like someone said, the status quo, I mean, that's an option to just let it run its course. And there's other options as well. Some people have mentioned a few things here tonight. But staff haven't had a chance to actually go through them, come up with a longer list of all of them. But there are other options, obviously. But the council is comfortable with one of these two options, and it doesn't make sense to go back and do other options if council likes them. Or wants to support one of these options.
Dr. Fancy?
I don't think any of us are comfortable with any of the decisions that you made. It seems to be quite obvious that this is a long term, even if you're saying you're putting out 3-4% now, and then in the debenture comes due, it's like buying a new fridge, and you get an interest free for this year, you're going to have to eventually pay for it. So. I don't want to pass it off to another council too. So I think I'd rather hear all other options. I'm not ready for a decision tonight. I don't know about anybody else.
The design process, I think it was quoted somewhere at like $85,000, something like that. So, and that would be an unbudgeted item, correct? Okay. So, is it possible to have options brought back? I'm assuming that would be under the discussion point. Is it all? No, never mind. I answered my own question. I was going to say, is it possible to have a recommendation for that planning if we could figure out where we want to go, but the recommendations come before, so that would have to be after.
Right.
Well, if no one else is going to say anything, then I'll move that we have staff prepare a report for options, because I don't think anyone is willing to make a decision.
Understanding that the options may well put us back to this point here. And it may well be that this is what we end up having to make a decision on.
I think the scary thing is to, we're at the point right now that we don't know what we don't know. So it's hard to make a decision based on us having no knowledge of the whole process. But we have to decide what are these jobs worth. If we're looking at a $200,000 loss every year if we do this, are 100 jobs worth $200,000? Are we willing to put $2,000 a year into jobs for that center that will create $30,000 in economic spinoff to the county in wages? It's just, you know, another way of looking at it, maybe.
Councilor Gidley, did anyone second Councilor Trouton's?
That's what I was going to second it.
So it's been moved and seconded that this come back with other options, may not necessarily be fixing it, just,
well, just to
all
see
the other options that we have.
Yep.
And then we'll have to make a decision, and we can't keep putting it off. We need to make a decision, one way or the other. Are we in agreement with that? Do we need to vote on that? Back with other options. One, two. Councilor Gidley, you seconded. Okay. And on that note,
I move that we include the agenda.
Moved by Councilor Gidley, seconded by Councilor Fox, seconded by Vera. All those in favor?
Can we just take the
break? Yeah, we can take a break. Okay. Okay.